Sunday's the third Sunday of January. That's our, just thought maybe you might want to mention that it's our annual report.
Annual meeting.
Yep. Yeah. As many people here as we can get.
Yeah, I was a week off in my mind. So next week, Vision Sunday here. And so get to go through what the last year was and get to see what is on the docket for 2023. So encourage everybody to come out and take part in that as well. I had it written down wrong in my mind. Wouldn't be the first time that's happened. Anybody else?
It's a different third Sunday.
Yeah. Anybody else? All right, Christine, you're up.
Good morning. This is Dave. Good morning. We're going to have a word of prayer together. Father God, what a wonderful day to be in your house. It's the beginning of a new year, despite the skip of snow out there, which we live in Illinois, we never know what we're going to get, Lord. But thank you that we got here safely, We ask that you be with us as we listen to the words of these songs and put them in our heart, listen to the words that Jim is going to be sharing with us later, put those in our heart as well, that they will sustain us throughout this week ahead of us and bring us back into your house again next Sunday to bring praises to you again. In Jesus' name. Understands our weaknesses and who knows how hard it can be to remain faithful.
He responds with grace and mercy when we are at our weakest. He stands before the throne of God, pleading for us. As we worship this morning, let us bring our fears and sins before the throne and leave them at the feet of God, knowing our High Priest, Jesus, is there waiting for us. As we worship Him, let us sing praises, lift prayers, and treasure His word in our hearts this morning.
Thank you.
his name was Zacchaeus, a chief tax collector, whom Jesus called down from the tree, and they went and ate at his house. Both men met with disapproval from the Pharisees, who questioned why Jesus would eat with sinners. Probably because Jesus best remembered meal is the last meal with his disciples before he was taken to Calvary. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 11, 23-26, "For this I received from the Lord, which I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you will proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'"
Jesus enjoyed meeting around the table with family, friends, and his disciples, and us. That's why he set up the time for us to meet each Sunday morning. Just as we'd like to eat meals with our loved ones, so does Jesus. He desires and longs for us sinners to be here every Sunday at his table for the meal he prepared for us. Let's pray. Lord, please bless this bread and juice as we come again around your table today. Help us remember all you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're doing something new with youth now, so they're going to be with us during prayer time, and then Faith takes it from there with a special children's church before they're dismissed. We have quite a bit to be thankful for, even though it's cold and snowy. Sun's out there. Anyway, Freddy, your grandbaby, number 7. Little Waylon, still a Waylon.
Yep.
And the wonderful opportunities we have as a church in this new year. We thank all those who helped during the dinner for the Thrasher family and for baby Brooks Bryant being home. How's he doing?
He's doing good. He's still in prayers. He has continued testing.
All right, so we'll just keep praying for it. It's good.
You make your mic on, please.
My help.
Try to signal you.
It's amazing what happens when you turn it on. Okay, thank you, Larry.
He's over there working.
Okay, do we need to repeat? I'm loud enough, I think. But anyway, we continue to pray for baby Brooks.
Yeah.
Any other praises? make sure that that happens. So, the new curriculum and the Awana program, blessings for our new year, guidance for baby who starts today on something new. Our family, the family of the Thrashers, Dennis and all of the brothers, sisters, aunts and uncles and cousins, there's a lot of them. They were very grateful for the dinner, but our prayers and comfort are with them as they get over the passing of Kenny. And then, of course, Logan, the passing of her mom, and the rest of the family. Ted Reed's family, he also passed. Diane Faber's mama has the flu. Dawn Keesling, open heart surgery. Boy, that was interesting. They got in there, I found out. Connie was talking to me about it. And they did a triple bypass. It wound up, it was much more serious than they anticipated. And the family got there safely over the weekend, and she's doing great. Going to be released tomorrow, isn't that awesome? Wow. DeMar Hamlin had a heart attack, cardiac arrest. He's up now, he's talking. I don't know if he'll ever play professional football again, but there's no limits to what God can do through this young man and his testimony, because he is really grateful and thanking everyone for all the prayers that rallied around him. If you had, were watching the game live, you know, he had that hit and he just, I was watching it. It was like, oh my. And evidently, it hit him just right at the right time and stopped his heart. Just one of those freak things that happens. And there's a young lady who just, I think she was 16. And she passed because her heart gave out some anomalies that we just aren't aware of. It's a sad, sad thing. Anyway, I'm going to also add protecting football from the woke environment, all of that contamination that seems to try to take over everything that is good and decent and American. So stand up against that. We're continuing to pray for a little William Dyer, and he lost his grandma. Any other prayer requests? Yes.
We need to pray for Jamie Walter Neumann-Schwanger with the passing of Jamie's sister.
Oh, okay.
Former youth pastor here.
Yes, that's the name that has the, it's
very long.
Very long and involved, and sounds like Neuschwanger, but it's longer.
I'm used to Neuschwanger, but there's an extra E in.
All right, Neuschwanger. Swanzenzer?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Any others? Faith!
Hello. My great aunt Pam tripped and fell earlier this week. Hit her head pretty good. Has been in a coma. And I
she's in a coma?
And I think she passed yesterday.
Oh, honey.
So that's hers for the family on that one.
Far too many people going home to Jesus around Thanksgiving and Christmas. For them, it's Thanksgiving and it's Christmas forevermore. But for those of us left behind, it's a very sad time. All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we just give you praise and thanksgiving for who you are. The fact that you love us so much, that you humbled yourself to become a human, born as a baby, raised as a young man, learning skills as a carpenter. And then, Lord, you set out to preach the word. It was so startling because your people had gotten so far away from the truth because of traditions. And you brought it back. You called out a group of men, and then you sent them out. And from there, your word spread around the world. You humbled yourself again to die on the cross, to take upon yourself our sins, our shortcomings, our failures, our sicknesses, and our diseases. You broke up out of that grave. You opened heaven's doors. You gave us new life, new opportunities, new freedom. You created a way when there was no way. For you are the way, the truth, and the life. And the life we have in you, that Zoe, knows no limits, has no boundaries, and is total, complete, with no shadow of death in it. For all these who have passed, Lord, we ask you to comfort their families, that you would bring them closer to you, depending upon you even more than they have in the past. And we thank you, Father, for your comfort, for your healing, for baby Brooks and baby Waylon and little William. We thank you for miracles of healing, like for Damar and for Dawn. And we just thank you, Father, that you are doing wonders. You are doing signs. You are doing miracles. Sometimes we don't recognize them, but they're always there because you're always there. Help us to reach out in fellowship, in love, in forgiveness, to support each other as a church, as the body of Christ. Help us continue to do what you call the disciples to do and preach your word, to go forth into all the world until every person hears the wondrous news of the gospel, the good news. And Father, in order to do that, we need tithes and offerings. And so we just thank you for those who give, many sacrificially. We thank you for the money that comes into this church that we immediately distribute. There are so many areas we tithe in, people we support. We just thank you for all of our missionaries. We thank you for those who reach out like the backpack program and the after school. All of the people that are touched by you. We thank you for the privilege of being your hands and your feet. Your eyes, your ears, a mouth that speaks comfort. We thank you, Lord, to not forget to humble ourselves each day. Ask for your guidance, your strength, your wisdom, your discernment, the knowledge we need to complete the task you have placed us here to do. And there is no greater in all the world than you, Lord Jesus. So it is in your name we pray. Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus our Messiah, our Savior, Lord. Amen.
Okay, Lieutenant. what do we think he said? He said, go and make disciples. Why would we go and make disciples? Any ideas? No? Because it's important to share God's word and everything that he does for us, and that he loves us, and that he loves other people. Right? Yeah. Do you have anybody off the top of your head that you can think of that you can share God's word with? So God shared that love with him, right? Yeah. Anybody else? Yeah. Everybody? That's a good one. All right. So where can we share the good news? Thank you for entertaining me, and thank you for listening. We're going to pray, and then we're going to go to the next, okay? All right, ready? Hey, God, thank you so much for everything you do for us, everything you do to fill our hearts and our minds with the good news that we hear every day, even the bad news that we hear that we can turn into things for your glory and that you use for your glory. Thank you so much for the opportunity to share your word, and thank you so much for your love, grace, and mercy.
You face Jerusalem. Here's what you need to do. Here's what you need to do. You've got to first shave your head. You dress all in black. You've got to wear a white robe. Eat only kosher foods. You've got to become a vegetarian. You face Jerusalem. You've got to face India when you pray. You pray only in Hebrew, and you grow a nice tooth. And if you do all of those outward cultural things, you'll discover God in the universe. I'm thinking this is crazy that someone thinks that they can force their culture on God and that God's going to be impressed by what you wear, what direction you face when you pray, what you eat, all these sorts of things. It seemed to me that if there was a God out there who could be known, he should be able to be recognized no matter where I face, no matter how I'm dressed, because he's God. Growing up, we always understood that we had our Bible and the Gentiles had their Bible, the New Testament, and that they were two completely separate books. Because the only people I knew who were believers in Jesus were all people in our public school who were Italian Catholic, I imagined that Jesus was Italian. And so the understanding that he's actually Jewish was a shock. And then to hear that the New Testament was written by Jews, I couldn't believe it. My expectation was the New Testament was like my grandparents had told me. It was a book on how to persecute the Jews and something you should stay away from. Of course, when you're told you should stay away from something, curiosity gets the best of you, and you've got to see it. When I opened the New Testament, I was expecting to find a handbook on how to persecute the Jews. My grandparents had warned me that it was written by people who killed the Jews. That's what I was expecting to see. And yet when I'm opening it, I'm reading a story written by Jews about Jewish people. The New Testament was a fascinating book. And so as I opened this book in the library, I kind of looked around, made sure that none of my friends had seen me taking a Christian Bible off the shelf. And I opened it. Here's the first sentence. It says, "This is the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham." So three people are mentioned, and they're all Jewish. I was very shocked. And as I continue to read, I'm reading the story of a Jewish man who was born in a Jewish village in a Jewish country, and one day walks into a synagogue and announces that he is the Messiah. The more I read the words of Jesus, the more I became attracted to him. It was as beautiful as anything I had ever read in any other part of life. As I came to faith that Yeshua, Jesus, was the Messiah, it was clear that that was the most Jewish thing I could do. This is not a person who's a renegade to our people. This is the one who was promised in our Bible, the 53rd chapter of Isaiah. It is astonishing. If you would just read that chapter, just without the Bible being around, you would say, oh, this is some Christian Bible, this is Jesus. When you realize, though, that it's in the middle of our Bible, our Jewish Bible. When I first came to faith, I dared not tell my father, because this is a time period in the 1970s when there were lots of gurus and cults, and he was very concerned about me getting involved in some crazy sect and going off someplace. So I waited for months, and when I finally told him, he was very skeptical. On his own, then, he started to read about Jesus as well. About a year and a half later, I told him that the fellow who wrote one of the books of the year read that this fellow was giving a lecture in the city of New York, and he agreed to come out to hear that person. And one of the most amazing moments of my life was the speaker said, "Would everyone here who is a Jewish believer in Jesus, would you raise your hand?" I raised my hand. My father also raised his hand. And I said, I looked over and I said, "Nah, he didn't say would all the Jews raise their hands, would all the Jewish believers in Jesus raise their hands." My father looked over and said, "Yes, I heard what he said." The decision to come to faith in Jesus as the Messiah was not something that was a momentary lark. It wasn't something that was a passing fad. And I could see changes in myself that I knew were not from within myself. I had kind of tapped in to a truth for our Jewish people that was very powerful.
You never know how a life is going to change. Sometimes a life change is in an instant. Other times it is a process. Sometimes it is a grand epiphany in a second. And other times it takes you months, maybe years, to get there. We all have a testimony. I thought about it. I wanted to begin this morning's message with his story. And I thought, you know what? I'm not going to try to retell it. I'm just going to let him tell it for himself. This is just one of many. You can go to YouTube and type in the words, "I met Messiah." And you will find video after video after video of individuals like him. Individuals that are high placed in every industry that you can imagine, sitting in a chair, telling their story about how they came to meet Jesus. For some, it began as an intellectual pursuit. For others, it was reaching out when they had hit rock bottom, trying to make sense of the world that we live in.
Now, Scripture tells us that if we search for God, and we search for Him using our heart, desiring to find Him, that He's there. That He's there, and we will find Him. But more accurately, He will find us. He will find us, and He will find us where we are when we need Him. Because He is always there. And so this morning we begin a new series entitled Reaching Out. And as you can tell by our graphic, there's a world map there. And it is reaching out. God's commission is our mission. And of course the words play, I go. As a church, we reach out to the world around us. But as we reach out, there is a corporate nature to it, but there is also a personal nature to it. In each one of our Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we are given the Great Commission. It is also stated again for us in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 1, that we are to be Jesus' witnesses in the world. And so over the course of this series, we are going to look at God's reach for the world. And each one of the Gospels has a different audience. Now, modern critics look at the Gospels, the narrative of Jesus' life, and they criticize it because there are differences. Matthew is not like Mark, Mark is not like Luke, and Luke is definitely not like John. But here's the thing. What happens when there is an automobile accident and you have a half a dozen witnesses to it? What happens if all of their stories are identical? You don't believe it. Because everybody comes at it from a different perspective. A person standing on this side of the street is not going to see it the same way as a person standing on this side of the street. The Gospels were written to different audiences. The stories are not going to be the same. Oh, there's going to be overlap, there's going to be parallel. But one writer is going to focus on certain aspects, while another writer focuses on different aspects. You have Matthew, you have Mark, and you have John, who were first-hand witnesses to Jesus' ministry. Then you throw Luke in there, who wasn't a first-hand eyewitness, but what does he say? I did my research, and I did a lot of research, and here is the story of Jesus. And each one of them, the Gospels written to a different audience. This morning's Gospel, the Gospel of Matthew, where we start, is God's reach for the Jewish mind. So that's why I started with the video I did of a Jew who reads the Scriptures and comes to find out this isn't a book on how to persecute the Jews. Not at all. As he said, I was shocked. I go in and I read, and it begins with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and on down the line, pointing to Jesus as the Messiah. So Matthew writes, for the Jewish mind. And then Luke, or then Mark, and then Luke, writing to the Greek and the Roman minds. And then you have John. And you notice the Gospel of John is so much different. The Gospel of John to the postmodern mind, it's more for us. In fact, that's one of the reasons why when people first come to know Jesus or are seeking out information about Jesus, where do you start? If somebody ever comes to you and says, I want to know more about Jesus, where should I start reading? Have them read the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John begins before the beginning and takes you clear through the end. But today we're in Matthew, God's reach for the Jewish mind. Now, the Jews are God's chosen people, chosen for a purpose. Not that they were more important than anybody else. Oh, they came to think they were. But they were God's chosen people, not just because God wanted to choose a people, but because there was a task. Their prophets had stated that you are to be a light to the world, a light to the Gentiles, and they shirked that task. And they faced the consequences. But God wasn't done with them. Because the prophets had said, the Messiah, is coming. And the Gospel of Matthew focuses on that Messiah coming. That is the story of Jesus that we get. There is a focus on the messianic prophecies that we find in Scripture. And then at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, we have our key text for our message this morning. And it's simply this. Go ahead and give it to us. The key text, Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. It's on page 835 if you're following along in one of the sanctuary Bibles. If you write in your Bible, and I hope you do, underline this passage. If you use highlighters, please highlight this passage. This is after the resurrection. Jesus has spent his 40 days with his disciples and those around, appearing to more than 5,000 people. I'm actually going to start with verse 16 instead of verse 18. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even until the end of the age." Matthew's first statement calls Jesus the Messiah. The hopes and dreams given to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and the Israelites are shown to come to pass through this one person by whom we date all of human history. From the genealogies in chapter 1 to Peter's confession of Christ as Messiah in chapter 16 to this commission given to the 12, which also applies to us, we see Jesus as the Messiah. That is the hope of the world. So here's our key thought for this morning. When ordinary people reach out to help others become faithful followers of Jesus, lives will be changed and our chaotic world will be transformed. That is the key thought for this message. But that is going to be the key thought for every message in this series. And as I said last week when we did our overview, does that sound familiar to you? Sure it does. It's our identity statement here at Lane Christian Church. It's on our sign down here by the road. And hopefully it's something that you have memorized. Something that takes hold of you on the inside. We are ordinary people helping each other become faithful followers of Jesus. And what does that help look like? It's as different as we are as individuals. God is always giving us open doors. Open doors to those who we are in relationship with here in this family. And open doors to those that we have never met. So those we know really well, those we've never met, and everybody in between. I've asked this question before. Why is it that the church exists? Well, I gave Oswald Smith's statement last week, and it's true. The supreme task of the church is the evangelization of the world. Now, we look at the word evangelization to tell people about Jesus. Now, that's the starting point. But what does Matthew tell us here? Verse 19, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations." Well, what is the difference between evangelization and making disciples? Well, evangelization is simply to tell people about Jesus. To make disciples starts with evangelization. You tell people about Jesus. You share the gospel that the Apostle Paul so eloquently stated in 1 Corinthians 15. That Jesus came, that Jesus died according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose again according to the Scriptures. He ascends into heaven. He's at the Father's right hand now, interceding for us. But you boil it down to its core. It is this idea that Jesus came and died to save sinners. That is the gospel message. And in the book of Matthew, there in the beginning, when the angel comes to Joseph, we get the first presentation of the gospel. He will save his people from their sins. Now here's the funny part. His people? I'm not just talking about the Jews. Oh, it starts with them first. To the Jew first, but also, we got to tag that also in there. It goes to everybody. In fact, I will argue, and a longtime preacher in the Christian church, Alger Fitch, argued that the New Testament was a collection of missionary letters. From Matthew through Revelation, we see the story of Jesus unfold. And each one of them is a missionary letter because it always points you to Jesus. He wrote a book, and I encourage you all, if you can find a copy of it, to do so. It's called Reading Between the Lines, the missionary message of the New Testament. And I have used it liberally in this series as we go through it. The supreme task of the church is the evangelization of the world, to make disciples, not only to tell people about Jesus, but to teach them. So you start with the gospel, and then you teach them. How do we teach? Many different ways. As Christians, our methodology is going to change. Times change. People change. How we teach people about Jesus changes. The message doesn't. Our task as Christians is to meet people where they are at, present to them what they need, and do so in a language that they can understand. And that language changes. How I learned about Jesus will be different than how those sitting up here on the stage, I don't know about you, I'm looking forward to what faith has in store for these kids. I've been in churches where we've done this before, and at times I think we adults get just as much out of that as the little kids do. In fact, there'll probably be some Sunday where faith gets done. I'm going to walk up here and go, yeah, I got nothing. Because she just did it. Because we need to approach Scripture often as a child. To stand in awe of the faith which is presented to each of us. But we learn. And those ways of learning change. I don't know about you, but there are times that I'd rather see a sermon than hear one. Any other visual learners in here? Stories. What's the best way to present Scripture? I am a huge fan of expository preaching. That's pulling out my Bible and going book, chapter, and verse. And we do it. But did you notice that Jesus is not an expository preacher? Oh, he went in and opened up the scroll of Isaiah and read through it and says, this has been fulfilled. So yeah, there's some expository preaching, but man, Jesus told an awful lot of stories. In fact, I could have played the message up here this morning, this story of a Jew becoming a believer in Jesus, and let me tell you, it's happening all over. And I could have just walked up here and said, yeah, I got nothing. Because that impacts you. When you hear the story of others, it changes you. When I was working in church planting as a communications and development director, any letter I sent out, oh yeah, people love stats and stats are fine, but you always started with a story. Why? Because it catches you. It draws you in. And that's what Jesus does. And I think that's one of the reasons why we have the four Gospels. Most of Paul's letters, oh yeah, there's some stories in there, but most of Paul's letters and John's letters and Peter's letters deal with theological issues and address problems in the church. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts are a narrative. They tell a story. And oftentimes, that story draws us in. I love what Einstein says about it. Here's Einstein. He's a Jewish individual. Whether he was an atheist or an agnostic, he never really said. But he did make the comment, hey, I was taught the scriptures. I knew both the Jewish scriptures and the Christian scriptures. And the story of Jesus literally jumps off the page at you. And no myth does that. Are we influenced by it? Has that story taken hold of us? We take that story, it impacts us. The gospel impacts us. It takes a hold of our lives. It changes who we are. As I said in the introduction last week, as I told you what we would do in this series, I talked about Paul and his statement, my gospel, which he uses a few times in his writings. It's not that he created it. It's not that he invented it. Several modern scholars like to pound on the drum that Paul took what Jesus said and changed it, twisted it, and transformed it. That Paul created Christianity. No, Paul didn't create Christianity. He simply proclaimed that which Jesus did. And when he said, my gospel, it wasn't that he created it, but that it had taken so far, so deep of a control of him, it was literally, woe to me if I don't preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Has the gospel got a hold of us? I'll go back to Oswald Smith. Wrote this fascinating little book called The Challenge of Missions. It's only about 40 pages long. If you want to read it, I got a copy of it. You can borrow it. But not only does he say what I said in the beginning about the supreme task of the church is the evangelization of the world, but he goes on to say that any church that doesn't take seriously its responsibility in evangelism has forfeited its right to exist. And I read that and I'm like, ouch. You ever had those times when somebody steps on your feet? Yeah, I've had them. But you know, I read that, and Oswald Smith, you may not know the name, he was one of Billy Graham's teachers. Canadian preacher who changed the world. His church sent $3 into the mission field for every dollar it used at home. Think about that for just a minute. The goal of transforming the world. So why does the church exist? To tell people about Jesus. In all honesty, the nation of Israel existed to tell the world about God. God tells Abraham, hey, I'm going to use you. You are going to be my people. I'm going to be your God. And I'm going to set you as a light to the Gentiles. See, God loves everybody. God wants a relationship with everybody. How do we know that? Well, Scripture tells us. And even at times, we're the Jews because they got this crazy idea that we're God's chosen people. God places them in that specific geographic area there in Israel, the crossroads of the world, to be a light. What do? They go hang out in the hills. They come to look down and be condescending towards their neighbors. But God still uses them. God still uses the Gentiles. How many Gentiles do you see in the genealogy of Jesus? How many messed up Gentiles do you see in the genealogy of Jesus? If you notice, Matthew is open and clear about how messed up Jesus' lineage is. One of the reasons I think that we can believe the scriptures are true is that it's not some grandiose story. I mean, let's be honest. If you wanted to tell a story, that's not the one you would tell. Because you see humanity, warts and all. You see Jesus' genealogy, warts and all. And in the end, the hero dies. That's not the story that most people would write. But that's God's story. And so here is God desiring a relationship with everybody. Some people get it, some people don't. Look at Jonah. God called Jonah. Go to Nineveh and preach repentance. He runs the other way. 3 nights in the belly of a fish. Oh, it changed his direction, but it sure as heck didn't change his attitude. I've said in here multiple times before, I do not like Jonah. Jonah is a jerk. He is a selfish, conceited, racist jerk. And the text never tells us that Jonah ever changed his attitude. But God changed his direction and used him anyway, and people repented. Nineveh repented. Now there's no evidence that they became followers of Jehovah God, but they repented. They did what God desired them to do. And we see that story play out. There's always a faithful remnant. You read the story of Israel. We've talked about the cycle of Israel's history as being the cycle of the world's history, where they're following God, they fall, God judges them, they repent, and then God brings them back to where they're supposed to be. And so God uses them. And the stories that we see in the Gospel of Matthew are always pointing people towards the end goal. God's word is history on display. His story. Moving towards an ultimate goal. And God uses his people to present that story. The patriarchs and the prophets set the stage for the kingdom of God. Jesus comes in and inaugurates the kingdom of God. There on Calvary's cross, the moment he dies, that revolution begins. God's kingdom come to earth. We all have a place. There is a place for everybody at the table. But that's just a reiteration, because there's always been a place for everybody at God's table. But now all conceivable obstacles have been removed. And we are called to take that message, to preach that message. But do we do it? How do we do it? Go ahead and give me the next slide up here, if you would. Some of you, maybe most of you know who Penn and Teller are. Illusionists. You got a show in Vegas. Penn Jillette is probably my favorite atheist. I pray for him on a regular basis. Some people get bent out of shape, especially the atheists. They get bent out of shape when people try to evangelize them, try to tell them about Jesus. I love this statement. How much do you have to hate somebody to believe everlasting life is possible and not tell them that? Someone asked him, do you ever get annoyed when people share Jesus with you? No, I don't get annoyed. Not at all. In fact, I would get annoyed if you believe in Jesus and didn't tell me about him. Yeah, we might get rejected. People might respond in a way that we don't expect. I mean, heck, the scribes, the Pharisees, the teachers of the law didn't respond to Jesus in the way that one would expect. They should have seen him as the Messiah. It was there. Plain as day, but they had a misconception about the kingdom. In fact, Jesus' own disciples, those that spent 3 years day in, day out with Jesus, even they messed it up. I take great comfort in the fact that the disciples were hard-headed and didn't get it. Because I know there are times that I'm hard-headed and I just don't get it. And then occasionally, God does what he does and comes along and smacks me upside the head. You go to the book of Acts, the beginning of the book of Acts, right before the Great Commission is given in Acts 1:8. Peter, the spokesman of the group, is God at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? And I imagine, of course not being there, but I imagine if you could watch that picture unfold in real time up on the screen, however you want to, you would see Jesus do this. Y'all still don't get it. They're looking for a physical kingdom. That's one of the reasons why the scribes and the Pharisees and the teachers of the law rejected Jesus. It's the best argument that I've seen given why Judas did what he did. Not that Judas hated Jesus, but that Judas had a misconception of the kingdom, and he was trying to force Jesus' hand to do what he wanted him to do. to have this physical kingdom. And Jesus is like, no, the kingdom's already here, fellas. It is that concept of already, not yet. It hasn't reached its ultimate fulfillment, but the kingdom is here and you are part of the kingdom and everybody has the ability to be part of the kingdom. John, the voice crying in the wilderness, repent for the kingdom of God is at hand. Is that the message that we preach? Do we preach that message? That is what the Gospel of Matthew does. It takes us through and it shows us how what God had said through the mouths of the prophets would come to pass in Jesus. And that we would take this and we would use it as a tool to evangelize the world, to make disciples of all nations. As we went through the Christmas season, my Sunday school class looked at some of the messianic prophecies. There are a couple of rules that we need to follow in interpreting prophecy. We talked about two planes of reality, the physical world and the spiritual world, and both take place at the same time. About things being literal language and figurative language and how you differentiate between the two. But one of the things that we often miss is that the prophecies that we have in Scripture, on which Matthew focuses on, those prophecies written hundreds and thousands of years before Jesus even shows up, are written for the benefit of the church. They were written for the benefit of those who were there at the time, but ultimately what is written here is written for the benefit of the church. This right here, the Word of God, the 66 books of the Bible, Genesis through Revelation, completed revelation that tells the story of Jesus, is our tool. The writer of Hebrews states it plainly. In the past, God has spoken to us in many portions in many ways, but here in the last days, speaks through us, through His Son, whom He made heir of all things, and through whom also He created the world. So Jesus creates the world. He comes, He lives among us, He teaches us how to live, He shows us how to give, and then He leaves. Holy Spirit comes down, Holy Spirit guides us and directs us, and then we are given this as a tool. You know, we don't worship the Bible, because this is a book. And here's the crazy thing. I can take this book, I can throw it down here on the floor, coat it in lighter fluid, set it on fire. Would that change anything? Not one bit. It's not the paper. It's not the words. It's the message. And that message from Genesis to Revelation is that Jesus died to save sinners. So here's the application. Go ahead and give us the next one. Disciple making does not mean winning converts. It means sharing the gospel with everyone, irrespective of the results. That's where that process begins. Sharing with everyone, irrespective of the results. Sometimes people will accept, sometimes people will reject. And sometimes that rejection, oh, it stings. It burns. In fact, I think that's the number one reason why people don't share Jesus. As I said in here last week, 250 or 240 opportunities on a weekly basis to come and hear about Jesus. But it's not just Sunday morning. What you say and what you do during the week takes part in that process. Praise team, go ahead and come back up. Here's our takeaway for the week. A disciple is someone who has moved from being a recipient of the church's mission to being responsible for the church's mission. We'll focus a little bit more on that one next week. As we have our Vision Sunday, as we look at what God has done in the past year and what He's going to do in the next year, and we'll look at Luke's gospel and how it plays out. And who it reaches for, because when you look at the four Gospels and the groups that it reaches for, it becomes all-encompassing. It's the entirety of the world. At one point in time, if you are here this morning and you are a believer in Jesus, you have been a recipient of the Gospel.
You have been a recipient of the church's mission. Now that you are responsible for the church's mission. This, my friends, is where our two questions come from. That we ask every week. Do you get tired of hearing them? I hope not. I hope it never becomes, we do it because this is what we always do. I hope it doesn't come to the point of, oh, now we know Jim's going to be done. You know, like taking George Burns' quote about the sermon, a good introduction, a good conclusion, and the two being close together as possible. No, the two questions, what are you going to do with Jesus? That is the question of salvation. To be the recipient of the church's message. Regardless of what we do, regardless of how we do it, Jesus should always be central to what we do. If you haven't accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we implore you, we beg you, we give this invitation, not because it's ours, but because we're compelled to. And then on the other side of that, after becoming a recipient, then we become responsible. Are you going to keep Jesus to yourself? Are you going to treat Jesus the same way the ancient Israelites treated God? That he was their special possession that they held close and so tight that they transformed him into a God of their own making? Are we going to do that, or are we going to go out and be the hands and feet of Jesus to share Jesus with the world? Because that's what we are called to do. How are we going to do it? How? Doesn't really matter. It's that we do it that matters. So that is the call. And part of doing that is doing life together. If you're here this morning and you're trying to walk that journey, to walk that path, and you're struggling, hey, that's why God gives us the gift of each other. That God says, hey, I want you to do this. God looks at us and says we can change the world, but we can't do it alone. It takes all of us working together. And sometimes that journey is hard. The struggles are there. And so we come together, we support each other, we pray for one another. If you're struggling this morning with anything, you know, you can come down here, we'll pray for you. You can grab me, we can go back to the back. We can pray together. Because in the end, as we live that life together, as that iron sharpens iron, not only are we blessed, but the world is blessed. So if there's any decision, anything at all, we invite you to come.
I can well say.
be able to gather together, to worship together, to celebrate together. And as we go out, we're going to ask God's blessing on our week, that we may not only be disciples, but that we may be disciple makers. Go ahead, reach out, grab hands with the person next to you, and let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the way that you work in our lives. And as we read and study and see what you desire of us, may we, like the prophet of old, say, "Here I am, send me." That we could go out this week, that you would place somebody in our path that we could share you with. That by our words and our deeds, that we would be your hands and your feet, knowing full well that we can't save anybody, but that we are simply tools in your plan of redemption. That we could use our gifts, our abilities, which you have so freely given to us, to point people to you. We thank you for the blessings of life, but most importantly for your son, Jesus. And it's in his powerful name we pray all of these things. Amen. Have a great week, everybody.
You too may be a little bit...